I want to teach tonight on the kingdom principles of the virgin birth. I was praying 2 days ago about what to teach tonight, and as we get ready to launch into tonight, we're beginning a whole new semester of B groups. So our B groups are launching all kind of ways. We have women B groups, we have college age B groups, discipleship groups. Tonight is a Believers University that's going to continue. We normally cancel and stop for the whole season, but we've had a lot of folks say they love the teaching that we're getting. So we're going to keep moving forward. So I appreciate you being here. So this is turning into a B group where we just dive in and get the truth of the word out. Chris Redmond in the back is launching a B group on the 12th of this month, specifically geared around this, where you'll be getting together weekly, where you can discuss, go deeper, fellowship, hang out together, eat together, and really do the community of what we do right here. Some B groups are going off of Sunday morning's messages, and Chris is taking Wednesday night, and we're just going to even take it deeper. So if you want to be a part of that, see Chris, you can sign up there. Let's jump into it real quickly. I'm going to take you through on our stage tonight. I'm going to walk you through a genealogy. I know a lot of times the genealogies in the Bible are quickly skipped over because we can't pronounce the names and we don't feel like they really mean a lot, but they mean a whole lot. And I was just praying about what to say. God, what do you want to say tonight to take us deeper, to help us grow in our faith? And this issue of the virgin birth came up. So for the last 2 days, I've just really been mulling over the kingdom principles behind the virgin birth. Is it something we even need to be concerned about? I think if you're raised Catholic, it's a definite thumb up yes. And if you're a Protestant, most of us just believe, well, he was born of a virgin. That's the end of the story. I don't even know why. I don't know the reasoning behind it. But how many of you know there comes a point in your faith where you need to be able to give the answers, right?
Yeah.
You need to be able to give an answer for your faith. So at Believers Church, we adhere to the virgin birth is critical and a necessity for salvation. Without it, salvation would not be possible. But I want to take it a little deeper and talk about why it's so important for us and what the kingdom principles are that are within the story of the virgin birth. The story of the virgin birth, I'm going to give you five questions that when we look at the virgin birth that become critical to us. Number one, why did God even need a virgin? And each of the questions I'm going to lay out are going to kind of play upon one another in an exponential way. So as we go deeper into the questions, it just will pose another question. Now, what I'm going to try to do is answer all of these questions in the teaching tonight, but I want to go ahead and lay out the questions. But many people will ask this, why did God need a virgin? Is that important to the Godhead? Why didn't he just pick a lady? So that brings us to the second question. The second question is this. Couldn't he, meaning God, fashion another human just like he did Adam to be a womb for Jesus? Meaning if he created Adam from the dust, why didn't he just create Jesus from the dust? Why didn't he just make Jesus that way? Or why didn't he just do it the same way he did with Adam? Why does he have to have a womb? You know, the question would be, if God can do anything, right? If he can create the universe, if he can create the stars, why couldn't he just create Jesus? Rather than having him to have to go through a life cycle of being born, being in the womb, 9 months in the womb, birth, and then having to wait 30 years on some girl to raise him with your fingers crossed in heaven that she doesn't blow it. Right? If you're God and you're turning over your only begotten son to a teenage girl, historically, they say Mary was probably between 15 and 17 years old when she said yes to Gabriel. It's a debatable age, but that's usually the age range, under 20 for sure. You know, what was God thinking to turn his only begotten son over to an under 20-year-old teenager? How many of you would just trust your entire life savings with a teenager?
No.
And so it makes you wonder why this was so critical. Why not just make Jesus and then let him die on the cross for you and not even have to mess up Mary's life? We're going to see that answer. That genders the third question. The third question is, Why did Jesus need to be born rather than created? It's critical that he be born. He had to be born of a virgin. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He could have seemingly just given his son, like I said, just boom, and there's Jesus. And not even have to worry about all the growing up adolescent struggles that Jesus is going to have. So why did he have to be born? We'll talk about that. Number four, why not just create Jesus a mature man? This has been asked by people. Again, why wait the 30 years? Why not just create him like you did Adam? Most people will, we don't know, but the assumption is Adam was probably made already in adult years. My theological belief is Adam was probably made at about age 30 because that's the place where the ministry of Jesus started, at age 30. And so that's just kind of my take on that, of how old Adam could have been when he was made, although debatable. Why didn't he just make Jesus that way? Again, it leads to the same question of this process from the womb to the cross, or to the beginning of his ministry, that really is obscure. We could argue, it would have been nice to get some of the adolescent stories of Jesus. Yes. Wouldn't you have loved to have been part of the stories of mom and Jesus talking when he's like 11? We do get one, and it's interesting. It's when he's 12 years old, when mom lost him for 3 days. Yes. And says, "Where have you been?" And he said, "Well, woman," called her woman, don't ever do that, mom will kill you. "Woman, why are you looking for me? Did not you know I had to be about my father's business?" So we do know this, even at age 12, Jesus knew about the father's business. I'm going to teach on this, I think, in a few weeks ahead, on what that really means. He had to be about his father's business. I, again, think if you want to go theological on this point, I think that to me would prove the age of accountability. That it obviously can be known by a 12-year-old what the business of the father is.
Right.
So if you ever want to know, well, where does an age of accountability fall, I'd say about age 12, that's where Jesus enlightened us that any preteen can know the will of God and the business of the Father.
Right.
And so anything below that could be debatable on whether or not an age of accountability matters. Number five, how could Jesus, this is a critical question, how could it be born of a woman and still be considered sinless? Now, if you're raised Catholic, I'm not, but I have several friends that are, and I've had several friends that were, and I've studied enough to know a little bit of Catholicism. The answer is easy in Catholicism, and what would it be? Mary sinless.
Yes.
So, mm-hmm. Why argue the point? Of course Jesus is sinless because Mary's sinless. I have to argue that point. I'll argue it later. I don't think Mary was sinless,
right,
because Romans 3:23 says all have sinned and fallen short of what?
The glory of God.
Is Mary part of all?
Yes.
Okay. So I would just argue that Mary had sinned because she's part of all.
Right.
And she was in the bloodline of Adam. I'll show you that. So, but that creates a huge problem. How can you be born of Mary and not be a sinner if what we teach as Protestants is true, that every person is born into sin? Well, the way we skirt around that is several ways. Way number one, we say that sin is passed on through the sperm seed of a man. And so God removed Joseph so that Mary could have this sinless kid, because Adam never passed the sperm along, and the sperm is what carried the generational curse of sin, and so therefore Jesus could be sinless. I don't really necessarily have a problem with that. I don't think if you want to argue it, I'm good with that. And I would love to debate it because it would be fun to debate. But it makes me say this. Okay, let's remove Joseph and just take stepdaddy out of the way a minute. We still have a problem. If Jesus is born a natural birth, that means he's connected in the womb through an umbilical cord, and the blood of Mary runs through his blood. Meaning that if the blood of Mary is tainted with sin, then she's passed that blood into Jesus. So that only leaves us one other option. Jesus was in the womb but not connected to the umbilical cord. If that be true, could we really say he was a real human? Because if you cut the umbilical cord, you die and you wouldn't be a human, so we could say God cheated. That he said he was a man, but he wasn't a man because he didn't come the way men come. He cheated. He cut the umbilical cord and gave himself a miracle life unlike us. And that's not what the scripture teaches. The scripture teaches that he became like us. He was us. And he was fully God at the same time. So I would argue that point, that he was hooked up to the umbilical cord just like we were, because he was fully human as well as fully God. Right. If you cut the umbilical cord to get rid of sin and just put Jesus in the womb and let him, you know, kind of bake a while like a human, then I would probably argue, is that really human?
Right.
Because if I cut your umbilical cord, you're losing your kid.
Right.
So I would say we could stand before God and go, well, you're cheating. Jesus isn't like us. But he is. He's fully human and he's fully God at the same time. So that poses how, we'll answer this, how in God's name can you get Jesus into the womb? We saw to get rid of Joseph. We don't have to mess with his passing on his genetic sin. But we do have to believe that Eve had the genetic code of sin passed to her through her mother and father. And she's in a sinful state. And now, and I think this is the brilliance of God, God placed the sinless sacrifice into a sinful state.
Right.
And incubated the sinless sacrifice in a sinful incubator. But it's so brilliant.
Yes, it is.
That the blood of the sin passing through Eve that also passed through Jesus, God had to have a way to where he could remedy that and still live up to his own character.
Right, right.
Because God hates sin.
Right.
Right?
Right.
So I want to try to teach that to you tonight. So those are five questions to get your brain scratching. Let's look at the kingdom principles of the virgin birth that are necessary, the kingdom necessity of the virgin birth. Here's number one. It starts in the very beginning of time, the kingdom necessity of the virgin birth. The scripture that we're going to read in just a minute is Genesis 3:15. It is the first real prophetic word concerning this thing called the virgin birth. But I do want to pull out some things that I want you to, maybe in your brain place, I want you to think about as we get ready to go on this journey. And let's go to Genesis 1, 2, and 3 here. And over the next 15 minutes, we're just going to scan through Genesis to see this play out. So you want to have your Bible and flip through it, that'll be great. You can highlight some scripture if you want to. I won't pick them all, but I do want to touch on all of them. But here's the first point. Why the virgin birth? All right, so it's going to have to come through a woman if it's going to be a birth. Now, here's why we can say it had to come through a woman, through a birth, because God bound himself to a woman's womb prophetically.
Mm-hmm.
So let's all open your Bible and let's just read it together. Genesis 3:15. It's after the sin of Adam and Eve. And he's actually talking to the serpent. He's not even talking to Eve, but God makes a statement about the woman, Eve, and we can pull it out and make some pretty true assessments from it. Genesis 3:15, speaking to Satan. And I, God, will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. Now watch this. He, Jesus, shall bruise your head, Satan, and you, Satan, shall bruise his heel. Now this scripture is 4,000 years prior to Jesus coming. And I've got Jesus coming over here some 4,000 years later. But there is this word that I want to talk about in Genesis 3:15 that shows us a kingdom principle, and it's this word that God uses, not us. I know televangelists use it a lot, but God initially started it. And it's this word, he said, I will put enmity between your seed and between her seed, which is going to show me something that Satan has a seed as well as humans. That's a strange thought. You know, if you want to really go deep with this thing, I mean, we could talk about this for hours and hang here, but just to stretch your brain a little bit here, perhaps, this is a perhaps, I don't want to go there tonight, it's not my teaching, but I do want to throw it to you. Perhaps when God spoke this about the seed of Satan, we could say that it's humans who turn to do his will, people. Okay? We could say Cain, Judas Iscariot, Herod, Nebuchadnezzar, just anybody that's wicked, we could just say human people. But we could go deeper than human people, and we could say that the seed of Satan is going to literally corrupt people, and that the angelic side of the satanic kingdom is going to come in to corrupt the seed of women so that there can never be a seed that could crush him. Because if I can corrupt all the seeds of humans, Jesus can never come. So this starts a strange topic throughout the Bible that will weave itself through, which sort of makes a lot of the Old Testament clear of why God needed to kill so many people off and why he refused to let his people marry any nation outside of his. We use it for racism, right? A black can't marry a white person because the Old Testament, God wouldn't let his people marry. That's just ludicrous. It's not about color, right, and it's not about nations and culture. It's right. About seed and seed.
Yes. Right. Yes.
A corrupt seed from Satan with a holy seed from God.
Right.
Now, when I say corrupt seed, my belief, you don't have to believe this. I'm not asking you to jump on my bandwagon, but I have a bandwagon. If you want to get on it, I got my seatbelt and you can sit by me. I believe that this prophetic word was so powerful that Satan, in his kingdom lair, began to put a mark on the womb of women.
Wow.
And his target became women.
Mm.
You will see it all through the Old and New Testament. The murdering of women, the murdering of babies.
Yes.
My opinion, again, I think this is factual more than an opinion. I think that is why the abortion thing in America is so devastating. It's not a woman issue, it's a kingdom issue.
That's right, Pastor.
Lucifer hates the womb of women.
Yes.
He hates the womb. This is why a woman, and you'll hear this argument in the abortion culture as we argue and debate this, I have a right to my body and my womb. Honey, I said this before, your womb is not your own.
That's right.
Your womb is a divine habitation of God.
Amen.
It is where God birthed out the Messiah, yes. And your womb,
yes,
is holy.
Yes. Yes.
It's a holy place.
Yes. Wow.
This is why sex outside of marriage is so devastating.
Amen.
This is why abortion is so devastating. Your womb is holy.
Yes.
Amen.
So the seed, my take again, I'll go back to my point, I think that angels, demonic angels, were having sexual relations with human women.
Right.
Yeah. Now, I know that's probably Greek mythology to you. I just believe it.
Right.
And I believe it because as we go through Genesis, you see chapter 6, you see the sons of God. I'll get to that in a minute with the daughters of men. But there's something interesting, if you've never thought this to be true, this will just make your brain kind of go, hey, I never thought about that. Do you remember in Sodom and Gomorrah in the story?
Come on.
When the angels came to visit Lot.
Right.
Right?
Yep.
And Lot took them in his house, and the men,
that's right,
outside the house start banging on the house. What did they want to do with the angels?
Right.
Have sex with them.
Yeah.
So that means that there had to be a possibility
right.
that you could have sex with a spirit being of some sort.
Right.
If you live, you know, I don't want you to go home and do this, but if you studied witchcraft and the covens of witches, they do believe
yes, they do.
That spirits and demons can have sexual
yes,
intercourse
they do.
With you.
Yes, they do. Yes,
I know we do. Christians just Err. But other religions and other faiths that go deep into the dark world believe that spirits can literally come down and have sexual intercourse with humans.
Yes,
strange as that may sound, I don't want you to go home and Google it, but but it's out there. Okay,
yeah,
I'll leave it at
is.
That. It's
yeah.
out there, and I kind of go there and I believe it because it starts. The Bible makes sense. But let's just leave it at what the scripture did say rather than speculate. Satan has a seed, and humans have a seed.
Right.
And the two never
yes.
need to hook up.
That's right.
This is why a daughter of the king is never to marry an unsaved man.
That's right.
But he's sweet.
Come on.
He goes to church.
Come on.
He came to church with me and gave me flowers. He treats me better than my ex who was a Christian.
Wow.
So what we do is we marry the seed. And again, this is what I said a few weeks ago. There's only two people in the world. Both of them have a father. Your father is either the devil or your father is God. There is no in between. There's only
Amen.
Two fathers in the world.
Amen.
Jesus said it. You're of your father, the devil,
Amen.
Or you can be of your heavenly father.
Amen.
So that really kind of just slaps politically correct thinking right in the face, right?
Yes. Yes.
There's only two groups of people.
Yes.
Those that are children of the king, those that are children of Lucifer, the two should never come together. So when God prophetically said this, something strange happened. I want you to really hold on to this. Once God spoke this prophetic truth about the woman's womb, it was all out war. I'm not talking about earthly war.
Come on.
I'm talking heavenly war. Once the prophetic word was spoken to Lucifer's ears, her womb,
that's right.
her seed is going to crush your head.
Yes.
Trust me that this angel Lucifer, who was created by God of a most utmost wisdom and brilliance, clued into war.
Right.
Wow.
If God, who cannot lie, said your seed is going to crush me,
that's right.
I'll come at you.
That's right. That's right.
And I'm going to take the seed of your womb. Yeah. I'm going to kill it all off.
That's right.
This is why Cain and Abel become such a strategic warfare.
Mm-hmm.
Because as soon as Cain and Abel are born, which are the seed of the woman, right?
Right.
As soon as the seed of the woman is born, he has one kill the other and the other gets banished.
Right.
So he just backs off and says, well, I don't have to worry. One seed is dead.
Yes.
Right.
And the other has been banished
right.
from the garden.
Right.
right? Where am I going to go? Away from the garden.
Right.
I don't know if Lucifer was allowed to stay in the garden as the serpent or not. We're never told. We don't ever told if he what happens to him other than he's going to crawl around on dust on his belly. But I do know this. I do know at that moment of time, there came a warfare to Lucifer. After the seed of the woman.
Right.
But remember, this is my thinking, I do not believe that Lucifer is all-knowing.
Come on. Right. He's not.
But I believe he has exponential knowing.
Yes, right. yes.
Meaning he's been around before the beginning.
Right.
And if you've been around that long, by the time you get over here to where we are in 2016, you have exponential knowledge of how it works.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Let me tell you something, honey. On your best day, you don't trick him because he's been watching us for thousands of
That's
years.
Right. Yes. That's
There's
right.
There's not a human in this room that Lucifer goes,
Yes.
That's right.
He knows what makes humans tick. He
That's
knows
right.
how to play with our flesh. He knows how to play with our emotions. He knows how to get us where he's been doing this for years.
Right.
But in the beginning, because he doesn't have all foreknowledge and he doesn't have all knowing, the only thing he knows to do is just kill the kids off.
Right, right.
What he doesn't factor in, I'm assuming, this is an assumption, is that Adam and Eve can go back in the tent and keep doing this thing over and over and over. Oh my God, here comes another kid.
Right.
And then another kid, and then exponential children being born. And then that's why I believe he goes a step further And rather than trying to kill off the exact children that are born, he goes to corrupt the actual seed of what's being born, which will be Genesis 6 in a minute. And then when he can't corrupt the seed because God annihilated all of that off of the earth in the flood, he tries to corrupt it again. But then rather than doing that, he just begins to kill off all the male children. Exodus 1. So let's run through it. I just want to take you through the Old Testament now and show you this war on women. Ladies, I'll just throw it to you. It's 2016. There's still a war on women.
Yes, there is. Yes,
and
there
it's
is.
Not about how much wage you earn.
Come on.
I'm all for equal pay here. Yeah. But believe me, this war on women is not about equal pay.
Right.
This war on women is that in the kingdom of God, you have power.
Amen.
This
Amen.
Is why the church shuts you down. This is why we don't want you to preach. We want to keep you quiet. We want to keep you subdued by men.
Right.
We don't ever want to put you in a pulpit. We want you to zip it and keep your mouth shut.
Yeah.
Because if the devil can't take you out, we'll just use religious people to do it, right?
That's right.
So the church will raise up full of spirit-filled women who are godly, who could take the world over, and the church gets so religious, we go, now here, ladies. We want y'all to go to the nursery.
Do tea parties.
We want to load the nursery up with all the women. Yeah, we want you to go have tea parties.
Right.
We want y'all to do makeup stuff.
Yeah.
And we want y'all to do all your women thing. And then doodle each other's makeup. Do nails.
Yeah.
But don't ever put a woman in the pulpit to prophetically start proclaiming the kingdom.
Hey. Lord.
Come on, Pastor.
I'm not against all of that. I'm for makeup. You look the best you can look. Make a work of it. But do you see how it works? All I did is just move into the church and shut women down.
That's
and now
right.
I just have women having little flower parties and
Come
tea
on,
parties.
That's it, Pastor.
Come on, ladies.
Yes.
Take your place in
Amen.
The kingdom of God.
Amen.
Be the women God has called
yes.
you to be.
Yes.
To be the, you know, hey, if you stand in this pulpit and preach, it doesn't mean you're usurping authority. It means you're taking the authority God
yes.
gave you.
Hallelujah.
I can be a man and usurp authority in a
right.
pulpit.
Amen. That's right.
I got off on that. That's from a mama.
Yeah.
All right, let's look at him. Let's run through the Bible. Genesis 4. Here's the first one. The murder of Abel and the banishing of Cain. And what I'm doing now is I'm going to take you through about 6 to 7 things on this war on women's seed. The first was the murder of Abel and the banishing of Cain in Genesis 4. Lucifer went straight for the seed. Why? Because it's going to come through the womb of a woman. The second one was this, the catastrophic annihilation of humankind. I put this as Genesis 5, not Genesis 6. You would think Genesis 6 would be the catastrophic annihilation of the flood. I almost disagree with that, although that was a catastrophic annihilation. Genesis 5 is the most depressing book of the Bible.
Right.
Just read it.
All the people that died.
Everybody dies. Everybody dies.
Yes.
We don't even get to chapter 5 of the Bible, and this side goes, he died, and he died, and then he died, and then he died, and then he died, and then he died. And then he died, and then he died, and then he died, and then he died. I mean, it's the most depressing.
Yeah.
You do get a little glimmer of hope when you read about Enoch.
Right.
And Enoch was translated. He still left the planet. Ooh, he's gone. You know? But Genesis 5 is tragic. Why? Because, hey, watch how the enemy's working. I'm not only going to kill off your seed when they're born. I'm not only going to attack the womb through corrupting the seed. I'm going to kill off everybody over time.
Right.
Because death is going to be working on you.
Right.
So you better hurry up. Now back then they lived to be 900 plus. So Lucifer had a lot of time to kill them off. Now we get about 80 years. So you better get busy with the kingdom quick like.
Right.
Get over your past and get busy working
yes.
for the kingdom.
Amen.
You don't have long at all.
Amen.
Amen.
Chapter 6 is the mingling. And I've talked about all of these. I just want you to fill in the blanks. The mingling of the seed with satanic activity. Where Lucifer, the sons of God, mate with the daughters of men. Now, if you're kind of wondering about that, the sons of God, I want you to turn your Bibles to Job chapter 37, because I had a great question last week. Hey, Pastor Mark, how do you know the sons of God were not just the kids of Cain? I mean, the kids of Seth, the godly boys. And how do you know they were bad angels? All right? So Job chapter 38, turn there, Psalms, and then just hang a left, and you'll bump into it. Job chapter 38, verse 7. Now this is God in this chapter revealing himself and his omnipotence, that's his all-powerfulness, to Job. And this is what he says. Let's start in verse 1. Let's read it. And the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, "Who is this who darkens counsel by the words without knowledge?
Come on.
Now prepare yourself like a man, and I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth?" Meaning this, Job wasn't around when God made the earth.
That's right.
So he just kind of throws that to him. Where were you? "Tell me, if you have understanding, who determined the measurements? Surely you know." He's kind of taunting him a little bit, just in case you didn't know what he's going on. "Or who stretched the line upon it?" Verse 6. "To what were its foundations fastened? Or who laid its cornerstones when the morning stars sang together?" Listen to this. Underline it in your Bible. "And all the sons of God shouted for joy." There were no humans in the creation, but there were angels. And the angels were referred to as the sons of God. Let two passages of Scripture confirm it.
Right.
So in Genesis 6, when it says the sons of God saw the daughters of men and began to have sexual relations, I believe that the angels saw the fallen angels, saw the daughters of men, and began to intermingle the satanic seed of rebellion with the women.
Yeah.
And that's why in Genesis 6, God, you often say, why? This is my opinion. Why did God annihilate everybody and only leave Noah?
Come on.
And there's one phrase in Genesis 6 you can read. "For Noah was found blameless."
Yes.
Not sinless.
Yes, right.
If he was sinless, he could have been the Messiah.
Right.
He was found upright and blameless in his generation.
Right.
And I believe what it's teaching us is Noah, again, in my opinion, Noah was the only pure family of humans left on the planet who had not intermingled with satanic activity.
Right.
And God looked down and said, "Who?" Noah found favor because he was blameless.
Right.
And God steps into Noah and says, "I've got something for you I need you to do."
Right.
I believe that's why one family was saved and not a bunch of families were saved.
Right.
My belief is the whole world, I don't know how many humans that would have been at that time, I guess we could speculate, the whole world, and Noah was the only righteous seed left. Because I want to tell you something, folks. When the devil gets busy, the devil gets busy.
Yes, he does.
This is why in the book of Revelation it says when he finds out his time is short exponentially.
Yeah, yeah.
I think this is why we see sinful behavior and all of this demonic activity of religion and beheading of Christians and all of this yang among humans and all of this racial tension and divide. I don't think it's because suddenly blacks and whites became aware of one another. I think it's because demonic activity realized our time is short and we've got to disrupt this world so that Christians are arguing with one another rather than taking the ground that they have. So that we're yang-yang over all of this stuff. And I'm not telling you not to be political. If that's your stick, do it. But I am saying don't be deceived into thinking that it's just politics we're fighting against.
Amen.
It is a demonic kingdom that's working in the unseen world to stir things up.
That's right.
Let's look at the next one, Genesis 11. And in Genesis 11 becomes the disobedience of the seed.
Right.
Here's what's interesting. In Genesis 9:1, if you like to do Bible studies, you could go back and highlight Genesis 9:1 and then draw you an arrow through chapter 10 to chapter 11. Here's what's strange. When Noah came off the boat, God spoke to Noah and said, your family needs to scatter, multiply, take over the earth.
Yes, replenish.
Yeah. Right? The original commandment given to Adam and Eve, he gave again to Noah, scatter, replenish the earth. Here's what's interesting. Noah lived to be some 350 years after the flood, Noah was still alive.
Yes.
Genesis 11 says all the humans of the world gather together and begin to build a city.
Right.
Do you know that Noah was there?
Right.
At Babel?
Right.
The dude that built the boat.
Yes. Wow.
Is it the Tower of Babel with his kids?
Right.
Building a tower to heaven. Do you understand in every generation, if you don't keep the prophetic word of God in front of you,
amen.
Suddenly what was a great moment of feat that you rescued the world by being obedient, over time, if you get lazy, your obedience of building a boat becomes the disobedience of building a monument.
Come on, brother.
Over time.
Yes.
And it's your children.
Amen. Amen.
The carry kids, the very family that God brought through, and Lucifer's like, I just got one family left. This is going to be easy. 8 people.
Come on.
All I got to do is distract 8 people. Yeah. Oh, it didn't take long. Just go read the story. By the time they got off the boat, Noah gets drunk. His kid gets cursed.
Yep.
Canaan gets cursed. It's the most crazy thing. Ham becomes cursed. I think that turns into Canaan. Right. Craziness.
Right.
This is the dude that built the boat. But yes. Even crazier than that, the guy that built the boat is the same guy standing there going, I just guarantee he's like, hey, y'all need to put another rock a little higher. Oh, come on, Jesus. Boys. Wow. The whole family has multiplied in disobedience.
Yes.
So if now what I can take the kingdom of this, if I want to destroy the seed of the king coming to crush me, I don't have to kill you off. I don't have to abort you. Right. I don't have to intermingle my seed. I'll just get you to be disobedient.
That's right. Wow.
If I can get you to be disobedient, I can stop the seed.
Amen. Amen.
You see how the enemy's working? Yeah. At every turn, he's learning more and more about humans.
Yeah.
First, I'm going to just kill the kids off. Then I'm going to corrupt her womb. And then after I corrupt the womb and corrupt the seed, and then all of a sudden God just annihilates everybody, I'm just going to get them to be disobedient.
Right. Wow.
This is why it's so powerful when Jesus walks the planet and says, if you love me, you must what?
Obey.
You must obey.
Yes.
It's non-optional in the kingdom.
Yes.
This thing of, oh, just love Jesus and live any way you want to is a lie of Satan.
Yes.
If you love Jesus, you must obey.
Amen.
You must follow my commandments. Isn't that works?
Yes.
Faith without works is dead. Teach that later, maybe. I'm getting off on that. And I go Pentecostal preaching. The next one, the chosen seed, Genesis 12. The chosen seed among all these people, once they're scattered, God scatters them all out. All the different languages of the world come from the Tower of Babel. God chooses a seed.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I have written up here on the board. I'm going to go through it with you in a minute. The choosing of the seed. God chooses a seed called Abraham.
Right.
And distinguishes Abraham among the nations. And God even uses the same language. Your seed,
yes,
will be like the stars of the sky.
Yeah.
Abraham's so confused. Like, how? I don't even know. I'm too old to have a kid.
Right.
Sarah's womb is dead. How is this going to happen? I do want you to understand that this seed principle to God is a huge thing.
Yes.
And God picks it back up with Abraham and says, let's get back with this seed thing. Why? Because there's another seed that's coming over here called the Word of God.
Right.
So God never forgets this seed promise that He has. Let's run through a few more chapters. The next is the barrenness of Sarah's womb, which becomes a distraction of the flesh. Now Satan knows if he wants to stop the seed of God, he doesn't need to get you disobedient. He just needs to distract you.
Okay.
How many of you have ever been distracted in your Christian life?
Oh, yes.
Good, everybody in the room, me included.
Right.
Distraction, does it even feel ungodly? No. I'm busy. I got a lot to do.
Come on, Pastor.
I got to get to work. I got 9 jobs I got to keep up with. I'm going nonstop. God ought to be proud of me. Matter of fact, I only need about 5 hours of sleep a night. I don't even need a Sabbath. I'm better than God.
Oh, boy.
So what you have to understand, as Lucifer's catching up with humans and watching how we operate, mm-hmm, he goes from this drastic intermingling of seed, murdering kids, abortions, and all of this stuff, mm-hmm, and now he begins to see there's many options available.
Come on.
There's not only disobedience, now all I have to do is distract you.
Come on.
God told Abram, out of Sarah's womb will come a child. And he gets discouraged over time.
Right.
Listen to me carefully. In the warfare of the kingdom, Lucifer will always play with time.
That's right. That's
always.
Good. Come on. That is good.
Pastor. When is God going to answer my prayer?
Come on.
When is God going to come through for me? When am I going to get my home? When will I get my husband? When will I get my wife? When will I get my healing? He always is going to play on when. Why? Because if the enemy can get you to focus in on a time frame, then all of a sudden what happens is you become distracted from the promise and you become inebriated with the problem.
That's good.
And you get distracted with the problem. I'm broke. I can't have a kid. Well, what did God promise you? Right. It's just been too long.
Come on.
So in this kingdom thing, you need to know when God promises, honey, there's no time limit. Just believe.
That's right.
But Satan will distract you. Hence, on the board here. Here, hence comes Hagar.
That's right.
Has Ishmael.
Right.
And God says, no, I didn't tell you through Hagar.
That's right.
I know you mean well. So I do want to throw this out about how Lucifer works. Sometimes Lucifer works through good intentions.
That's right.
That were never the will of God anyway.
Come on.
But it's good intentions. I meant well.
Come on.
I left that church mad, but I meant well.
Come on.
But you got distracted.
Right.
And so the enemy plays and uses it against you, and he's working his magic on, again. You say, where are you going? I'm just trying to teach you. He hates the seed. He'll do anything he can do to distract it, to disobey, to distract you, to cause you to get inebriated with the problem rather than the promise. Whatever he can do to stop this seed. Why? Because it's so profoundly prophetic.
Yeah.
I do want to say this to you. This is a thought. Lucifer... And I think this is what's going on in American churches. I don't know all of them, but just what I feel in my heart. Lucifer is so intimidated by the prophetic.
Yes, he is. That's right.
Because the prophetic is the mind of God toward the future.
Yes.
And he doesn't know the future.
Amen.
Right. He only can operate in the moment.
That's right.
I believe this is why churches are loading up and there's no prophetic move at all.
Come on, say that.
We're just doing programs and light shows and great music and good preaching. Not against it. I love it all. I like all of that. I'm moved by all that stuff. But let me tell you this, it doesn't move the devil at all.
Amen, that's right.
But you let the Holy Ghost
break out,
and you let a prophetic word come, Satan's on all fours, like, what's going on?
Yes.
They're talking about something I don't even know about.
Yes.
They're praying prayers toward their future. No. I mean, you know what I mean? That prophetic, he cannot handle the prophetic.
Amen.
So what does he do? He shuts it off.
Yeah.
It's over. It's done with. It left with the apostles. It's fleshly. It's not for today. We can just entertain people for 30 minutes and go home. No.
Amen.
So again, prophetic. Look at this. Now this, I talked about this, the perversion of the seed of women. Genesis 19. So what do you mean the perversion? I think we see it today in 2016, but I'm going to go back to Genesis 19 with it. I'm just blown away at this story. It hurts my heart. B, I just going to have to get to heaven and ask him what he was thinking. Lot is in his home with two angels of the Lord that have come to visit him. The men are knocking on the door to have sex with the angels. And Lot offers up his daughter to be raped all night long by men. For whatever cultural reason we want to say, for whatever theological reason of his honor of the people of God, but folks, there is a big problem when the daddy of the home begins to pervertedly offer up his family to the ways of the enemy.
Come on.
And I believe this same spirit has gotten in our homes today.
Come on.
Spirits of perversion.
Yeah.
Because dads are looking at porn. Dads are playing games with perversion.
Come on.
And this perverted spirit comes in the home through our movies, through our commercials, through our music, and through our television.
Yeah.
And we just offer up our children as objects of perversion to this world.
Come on.
And we never teach them how to live holy, upright, and godly lives. And if you don't believe it's true, I guarantee you, even tonight, most men sitting in this room are struggling with perversion of thoughts, of images, of struggling one way or the other with the bombardment of perversion. It's in every movie, every commercial, every song. You sit, you're watching the news and you get lingerie commercials. You're watching the news, you get a hot babe in a tub drinking a Miller Lite. It's just all over perversion.
Yes.
One of the girls that's friends with my daughters in the 12th grade, multiple sex partners every single weekend.
Wow.
Just living it up. Just
nice.
Perversion of thinking.
Come
Why?
On.
Because if I can pervert the thinking.
That's right.
The enemy. If I can pervert the thinking, I can corrupt the seed.
That's right.
That's right?
Amen.
So he's working hard on it. The next one is this. It's the destruction of the male seed at childbirth. Exodus 1. Lucifer now begins to understand, if the king is going to be a male child, I'm just going to eliminate all males. You remember the story. Pharaoh just says, hey, go kill all the babies. As soon as they come out, kill all the males. He's nervous about a king. The same is true in the New Testament. I gave you this in the New Testament. It's in Matthew 2. It was the eradication of potential male kings. Herod's nervous. The wise men say he gets mad. They don't come back and tell him. He gets upset. He says, hey, look, just go kill every kid within 2 years old that's been born. Kill them all. Any male kid, he's threatened by the king.
That's right.
He's threatened by this new potential king that could take over. So as we come through and get closer to the seed, I just want you to understand, as we get closer to the seed, the male starts kind of showing up and kill all the males off. And by the time we get to Herod, it's kill all the males who could be a king.
That's right. That's right.
See, Satan's cluing in on this thing as time progresses. And he's cluing in and he's getting deeper and deeper. All right, we're going to shut it down right there. And we're going to pick up here next week because it'll just go deeper and deeper over the next. We've got 10 minutes. So let's do this. Since it's a B group, let's open it up for questions or discussion. All right? Any questions, any thoughts you have, anything you would like me to discuss? While you think, all right, let me run through this because we're going to look at it next week. Just show you where we're going. Why the virgin birth? Adam and Eve have children, Cain and Abel, that are killed off. Seth becomes the line of Jesus. Seth runs down. I didn't put everybody, but I highlighted the people that are in these lines that you would probably know about. Noah is in the line. Shem is one of Noah's kids. Through the line of Shem comes Abraham. It splits off. Hagar has Ishmael. These right here, it's prophesied he will be a wild man. These are the Arabs that are alive today.
Yeah.
And Isaac are the Jews that are alive today.
Yeah.
And honey child, they were fighting back then. They still fight today.
Yes, that's right.
It's all
that's
over
right.
the news. It's just a prophetic thing. So if you think it's about a little piece of land, honey, it's prophetic.
Yes.
They're going back to day one. This is why, this is another thought. This is why the Arabs feel like that the land is theirs.
Right.
Because Ishmael was the firstborn, and they feel like they have rights through the firstborn child of Abraham.
Right.
Still connected to Abraham. The Jews say, yeah, Ishmael was the firstborn, but the promise was given through Isaac.
Right.
So we are entitled to it. And this is why they fight over that land. Sarah, 90 plus years old, has Isaac. Isaac has Jacob. This is where we get the 12 tribes of Israel, the nation of Israel. Jacob's name is changed to Israel. And 12 kids come out of him, but Judah is the one we're going to pick out of the 12 where the line keeps going. Down the line through Judah is a dude born named David that is going to become a king. This is where it splits off, all right? It splits off with David killing off Uriah's wife. And I will challenge you, in the Bible, God never calls Bathsheba David's wife.
That's right.
She's always called the wife of Uriah.
That's right.
So even though she did marry David, God never affirms it. But they have two children, first Solomon, who will become the kingly line of Jesus, because Jesus has to be the King of Kings, right?
That's right.
And God, we're going to look at all this next week. God gave a prophetic word to David that on his throne would sit Jesus, on the throne of David. Through the line of Solomon, who's the kingly line of David, we come down to Joseph, which is the stepfather of Jesus. But God won't let him have sex with her. So I got a dotted line to Mary. Mary is connected to the biological line through Nathan, right, another child of Bathsheba and David.
Yeah.
And Nathan runs down to the line of Mary.
Right.
The reason this is critical is a prophetic word had to come that Jesus would be both king,
yeah,
and both connected to Adam.
Right.
So through Mary, the biological side, he's connected all the way back to Adam.
Yeah. Yeah.
But because of Solomon and Joseph coming all the way down, he's connected to the kingly side,
mm-hmm,
of King David.
Yeah.
And what we'll see next week, you can go study it, not a lot on it, but it is interesting. In this line of Joseph, which is one reason I believe Joseph was not allowed to have sex with Mary, there's a dude that shows up named Jeconiah. There was a curse put on Jeconiah that nobody in his future could ever sit on the throne as a king.
Hmm.
It was a curse pronounced. So if God lets Joseph hook up with Mary and Jesus is born, Jesus could not be king because Jeconiah's curse.
Right.
Otherwise, how could Jesus be king if the curse on Jeconiah is your children won't be able to have a king that sits on the throne? So this dude's going to have to be dealt with, and I believe that's why the virgin birth is going to deal with this. All right, so we'll talk about that next week.
Wow.
All right, any thoughts, any questions you want to ask?
Wow.
Yes, Josh.
Going back to what you said in Job 38, verse 7, when the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy, what would you say the difference between the morning stars and the sons of God, because we see Lucifer, how Lucifer, a morning star, was fallen. Also, Psalm 19 talks about how the firmament and the heavens sank, they all sang together at the creation. So is there a difference in the ranks of the angels?
Yes,
is that is. Talking about physical stars? Is there a connection between stars and angels?
I think it could be both. I think it could be if Lucifer is the morning star, oh bright Lucifer, that's kind of what it translates. If he's over all of those as worship, they could be the fallen angels that went with him.
Yeah.
Who left their estate and came with him,
yeah,
and followed him, and they became the fallen angels, sons of God, still angels.
Right.
So I think either or maybe. You know, I wouldn't fight one way or the other over it. I think both have a possibility. Yes.
Was he replaced when he just vanished?
Who?
Satan.
What do you mean by replaced?
By somebody else.
No. The gifts and callings of, the question was Lucifer replaced when he fell? My belief is the gifts and callings of God are without repentance.
Right.
So once God established Lucifer as a cherubim angel, we know there are three, Gabriel, Michael, and Lucifer. There could be more. The Bible doesn't tell us. And that's why one third of the angels went with Lucifer, because I believe each of those three angels governed a third of all the angels that worshiped around the throne. So when Lucifer fell, because of authority, they followed him into rebellion. It could be an authority issue. I just struggle that's a big art of deception when you can take one third of the angels to run with you in rebellion,
right,
and leave their estate.
Right.
I think it means two things. Be careful of the spiritual authority you're under.
Amen.
Because it can lead you astray as well.
Amen.
And then no matter who you are, you can be deceived. So
yeah.
I think you have to play with that. But to answer your question, did God replace him? No. I think God created Lucifer to be the covering cherub, and those that still works today. It's why he can blind the minds of Christians in the world. It's why he can do what he can do. He still has power. It's why he still can possess people with his demonic kingdom. It's why he'll be able to work miracles in the Old Testament. He still carries that within, I believe now, the thing governing now is the church. And I believe we're the one that keeps Lucifer at bay from just having an all-out war with whatever he wants to do on this planet. I believe we, the church, keep him at bay with our authority.
The whole nation.
I think that's the Spirit of God in us holds that back. with him working. So no, I think he lost the estate, and could he repent? You know, the question is, if what if Lucifer decided to repent? Would God forgive him? Yes. God would be obligated to forgive him, but Lucifer's never going to repent, because the only way to repent is to be drawn by the Father and to be drawn by the Holy Spirit, and Lucifer's not going to listen to the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Right? So that's my take on that. It's never even going to be a question for him to repent.
Amen.
Yes.
Okay. I grew up Baptist, right? And one of the things that they used to say was, you know, when you moan, the devil can't hear you, right? Mm-hmm. Now, is that because they took that from when you, the prophetic tongue, he can't hear you, or the actual moaning?
Okay, the question was, she grew up Baptist. She was taught that when you moan, the devil can't hear you. My take on that, if you know other, you can help me out. I've never read that in the Bible anywhere.
Me either.
That when you moan, the devil can't hear you. So I would have to just go, that doesn't even sound scriptural to me, right? Even though it's probably religious sounding. It sounds great. If you moan, he has no clue what you're saying. Here's my take on that. I mean, I'm a logical thinker at times. The devil will sit with you for 2 hours while you moan.
Yeah. Amen. That's absolutely
moan all you want.
That's right.
He'll just sit right beside you, and then when you're done moaning, he'll get up and follow you right out the door.
That's right.
And then when you're done moaning, he'll go, okay, let's chit chat now. He'll buddy up with you. And,
amen.
And you say, how do you know that? Because he did it through Judas Iscariot.
That's
3
right.
years walking with Jesus.
Yes.
Just walking along with Judas and the other 12, just waiting on his time.
Right.
To play his cards just right.
Yes.
So listen to me, the devil doesn't care if you come in here. He doesn't care if you sing. He's
Amen.
Just waiting on a time to play his cards. This is why you have to hear the Holy Spirit. So it's not the groaning that upsets the devil or causes him not to be able to know. It's when the Holy Spirit begins to speak that he gets...
That's right.
Because he cannot come against the speaking of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Because the Holy Spirit is ahead of him.
That's
why?
Right.
The Holy Spirit will show you things to come.
That's right.
The devil doesn't know what's to come.
Amen.
So when a Christian's operating in the Holy Spirit, you're a step ahead of the devil. And when you're operating in the flesh, he's a step ahead of you.
That's right. Every time.
Depends on who you want to be in front of the cart on that one. All right, one more question
Amen.
Before we go.
Amen.
Got about a minute left. Yes.
This is more or less like a question, just like a thing that kind of clicked together for me through tonight.
Okay.
Was like, it says in, you know, the New Testament, when two or more come to my name, you know, forms the church, right? Mm-hmm. As such, we are born again, you know, through the church, and Christ is like, I don't know what I'm trying to say, Christ is the bride of the church.
Mm-hmm.
So does that mean we are being born again through the church? Like God cannot, that Satan cannot enter essentially the womb of the church? I don't know what I'm saying. The womb of the church, essentially.
Right, I understand what you're saying. The question is, if we're born again in the church, can Satan come against the Christian within the womb of the church, right?
Right.
Here's my take on that. And you may disagree. There is a supernatural power, scripturally, to the body of Christ.
Yes, there is.
That we have let go of in this modern generation.
That's right. That is
because
so
there is a church on every corner.
Right.
But in the New Testament teaching, when the gentleman was sleeping with his mother-in-law, having sex with her, and Paul said, look, push that brother out of the church so that his flesh can be destroyed by Satan, so his soul could be saved. My theological belief is that the true church of God, when you're born again, baptized by the Spirit into one body, the body of Christ is a safe haven from the work of Satan.
Amen.
Yes, it is. Yes,
amen.
It is.
And this thing of, man, I'll just go if I want to go. If I have time, I'll go. I just hop from church to church. You need to be in a body.
That's
the
right.
Body of Christ is a safety measure from the power of Satan when it's operating right. I think sometimes we can have a religious show and, you know, the devil doesn't mind. But a Holy Spirit-filled operating church body, it is a hedge around the believer.
Yes.
And I don't think, my opinion is, I don't think anywhere in Scripture we see that the devil can penetrate into that thing.
Amen.
The only thing he can do is deceive and try to raise up people from the inside to destroy it.
Yes.
To get you and you and you and you arguing and bickering and fighting and becoming cancer to eat itself out.
That's right.
While he just gets your flesh to take it out rather than himself.
That's right.
That's why it's so important to not be divisive and not be gossiping and not be let strife and division come into a church, but to guard each other in the body because we are holy.
Amen.
And we are a holy body. And so I believe, yes, I believe when you're born again and you're baptized by the Spirit into one body, the body of Christ, I believe there is a supernatural covering over the body of Christ. Amen. That Satan cannot come against.
Amen. Right.